You just watched way too many trailers for The Irishman, coming to Netflix this November. Up next, Connor reviews Joker. Later, getting Angelica a sandwich after wasting the morning filming a review.
Hey everybody, welcome back. We're gonna do a review today of the newest entry into the DC canon of superhero films, or maybe supervillain films. Today we're talking about Joker. I'm not going to mince words about this. Shortly after this video comes out, I am going to do one of our deep dive episodes because there's a lot that I want to talk about that requires spoilers, and this is of course a non-spoiler review. So, how can I best get into this without giving too much away? Well, I can say this about Joker, and I've talked about it on the show before, some of the best movies to me are the films that really grow with me afterward. When I left Midsummer, I remember I felt pretty depressed and dark and brooding for a couple days. I mean, it's a film that stuck with me, and the more that I thought about it, the more I appreciated the subtleties and what it was trying to accomplish. Joker very much had the same effect on me. I can tell you this right now. There are a lot of reviews out there saying it's one of the greatest films of the year, it's a 10 out of 10, it's, you know, one of the great films of all time. I don't know if I'd quite go that far. I think it's definitely a 10 out of 10 as far as comic book movies go, though, and part of that is it's probably one of the first adult comic book movies we've really seen in this era. And you could argue Deadpool, and I get it, it's rated R, and you know they got nudity and they swear a lot, and I get it. But I feel like it's still really built for teens. Joker, in a weird way, for a character who's been plagued by the Hot Topic target and trying to merchandise itself towards teenagers and kids, Joker didn't come across that way to me. And I really felt like this is a very mature character study that we really haven't seen in comic book films. Well, I'm going to talk about some of the controversies related to it later. Really quick, here's a summary of whether or not you should go see it. You should go see it. I think almost everybody would kind of enjoy it. I know that for me, one of the aspects I liked is that, yes, it very much is a love letter to Scorsese's films. I know that there was a lot of talk about how the writing crew was influenced by The King of Comedy with Robert De Niro. I know that they talked a bit about Taxi Driver as sort of being influential on the world they created. And it shines through. It absolutely does. For some people, it may just want to make you go see a Scorsese film afterward, if you prefer that kind of a movie. But I think the tones that they brought out and some of the motifs they brought out from a Scorsese-type picture are really effective here and are really suited to a Gotham City. And in this world of Gotham City, we pick up following a character named Arthur, played by Joaquin Phoenix, who is, of course, on a journey to become the titular Joker character. And Joaquin Phoenix, there's no other way to say it, is fantastic. It's one of his best performances, and one of the things I'll say about it is it transforms every cliche about the character. It's, without giving away too much, probably the first time you ever see a Joker character who's not a cunning, malevolent supervillain. It's an everyday person, and that's what makes it such kind of a scary movie. And whether or not it's a comedy or an action is sort of a question I'll answer a little bit later. But Joaquin Phoenix does, thanks to a script that really gives him space to perform and own a lot of real estate in terms of time, in terms of characterization, because it is, again, almost a solo character piece. Joaquin Phoenix is able to take elements from that script and play off of silence or opportunity to maneuver and manipulate his body in a way that could feel forced, contrived, or silly, but ends up feeling like a really intimate insight into a deranged character who may or may not have any hope left in him. Another key aspect I have to credit him for is probably the best Joker laugh ever committed to film. Part of that is due to his extensive research. He had talked about going out and visiting institutions. He claimed to be around people with schizophrenia, multiple personality disorder, other delusional effects, and there was a laugh with a dissonance to it that wasn't necessarily a humorous laugh that he was able to sort of adopt and transform. And without getting into why that is in this movie, his laugh is, it's an embodiment of what I think scares people about clowns. And it's that they're smiling, but that smile is so fake, and the person beneath it could be anything, John Wayne Gacy. And in this, his laugh is really tragic. It visually seems to hurt him as he laughs, and as the audience, it makes you really compelled to empathize with the character. I want to credit the rest of the cast. Everybody there is pretty good. I can't really think of any actor who I thought was bad. However, because it is such a character piece, really all the real estate belongs to Joaquin Phoenix. And probably the only person who comes close to stealing the show at certain points is Robert De Niro. But De Niro, again, is sort of playing a caricature. He's doing exactly what he has to do as sort of a Johnny Carson slash Rupert Pumpkin-esque kind of character. But that focus on Joaquin Phoenix really serves the movie well. Additionally, I have to say, I was able to see this movie at the Loft Theater in Tucson in 70mm, which is, if you can see a movie on film, it's gorgeous. You get the little crackles in the dirt after only like 7 screenings, so it just has that kind of film look to it. I just, for some reason, prefer that over digital film. And what it really highlighted is how gorgeous the cinematography is in this movie. The audio is also really, really stellar. From a technical perspective, it's one of the best made comic book films going back to the Nolan series, and I'm personally biased towards Watchmen, for instance. The script itself knows how to create opportunities for its lead to deliver great content for the audience, but it also knows when to be quiet. It knows when not to give out exposition. And I think that lack of exposition really enables the film to create a Joker not unlike some of the best graphic novels and stories told in DC's history. A character who is an unreliable narrator, who is maybe a liar, who sees the world in his own way, that is very far from how we would see it. And that can be a lot of fun because it can create ambiguity and questions as to what actually happens or what's in the character's mind. And of course, there are some scenes in this movie that try to go out of its way to show you that, to illustrate that, and reinforce to the audience what may or may not be real. I think there are a lot of other things that I'll talk about in the deep dive that ambiguity and the pacing of the script and lack of exposition really enables the audience to explore. Of course, you can't have a DC film in the Batman universe without involving the Waynes. I really enjoy sort of this reinterpretation of the Thomas Wayne character in this movie without giving too much away. It's definitely not what you're used to, and it's an interesting character that plays a foil to your protagonist. On the flip side of that, I think the biggest waste in this movie is there's a scene involving a young Bruce Wayne that I think really could have been cut out of the movie. It didn't really do much for me. But that said, a lot of what I was worried about in this movie, Bruce Wayne, for instance, shown in the trailer, things of that nature, was how much that trailer, which has been everywhere for the last month or two, was gonna give away about the movie. I've talked about it a lot on this channel. I hate when trailers give everything away. Watching this, it was interesting to see how certain moments from the trailer had clearly been recontextualized, even different takes occasionally used, so that you kind of understood what you would get from the movie, but you rarely felt like, oh my God, you know, I'm watching the trailer, but it's 2 hours long now. The only exception being what you see in the trailer, one of the first scenes where Joaquin Phoenix is playing a street clown with a sign and he gets attacked. That was one of those moments where it's like, I've seen all of this, but that's probably the only moment that I thought was truly ruined by the trailer. All of that said, for all of the compliments I've given this script, I do have to say, if I didn't know until afterward that it was a script written by the same writer from The Hangover, it wouldn't have surprised me, not because there are similarities between the two, but the actual content of that script is probably the flattest element of the film. You do wish that certain scenes maybe had a little more originality or some more interesting or original dialogue that could be delivered, but in the end, it didn't particularly distract too much from the film for me, mostly because this is not your Heath Ledger Joker, which is a sort of philosophizing terrorist. This is really a nihilistic everyman, and I think that's what made the film so scary. And it creates sort of a baseline of chaos and darkness that enables it to deviate and escape that tonality. So when you do have moments of humor, albeit dark humor, or moments of action, or bizarre music sequences, because it was such a deviation, it was actually sort of welcome, and it made those scenes resonate more, where I think in another circumstance they would have felt forced. Now, that's kind of my summary of whether or not, without spoiling anything, you should see it. It is incredibly well acted. It is visually beautiful. From a technical standpoint, I loved everything about this movie. And the more I think about it, which I'll elaborate on in the deeper dive, the more I really enjoy some of the subtleties to the movie. Now, that said, I do want to get into the controversy really quickly. There's been a handful of things that I've heard. Some people said that they thought that the Joker was being used as some sort of a icon for, I've heard like red pills and MRAs and misogynists and such. I really didn't get that. I especially feel like this is the first time a Joker's been created that I don't see anybody looking at and saying, oh my God, I want to be that. You know, it's not a cool character. It's not a hot topic icon. So I don't really get where that's coming from. I think there are a lot of political undertones to it. To really get into that, I think that's something for the deeper dive. Suffice to say, it's not too in your face, and people that I saw it with either saw what I saw but interpreted it differently, or thought that it was an apolitical film that people maybe are reading too far into. But the final thing I want to get into is there's a bit of a controversy from the victims of the Aurora Theater shooting and other active shooter survivors who have been talking about whether or not this story, especially involving the Joker, is appropriate. For those of you who don't know, the Aurora Theater shooting, the night of the release of The Dark Knight, featured a gunman entering a theater who, he wasn't dressed as the Joker, he's an idiot who thought he was dressed like the Joker, he just had weird hair, but he referred to himself as the Joker and committed a heinous crime that we should all be able to condemn. And so, people seeing this movie as sort of the next really big follow-up and successor to the Nolan series are a little bit upset about it, especially because the Joker is your protagonist and he is a madman with a gun. For a little bit of context, a lot of my career before I began doing these reviews, I was in Washington, D.C. working as an analyst. A lot of my work actually dealt with active shooter prevention and speaking with survivors. And so few people in this world have more empathy than I do when dealing with this issue. I simultaneously understand the concerns of these people. And again, when I went to the theater last night, and I've heard these stories all around the country, there was a huge police presence. People are still worried that something like this can happen. And it's very unlikely, but I understand that concern. At the same time, I feel like this movie, if understood or approached correctly, is trying to criticize that very type of person and is trying to tell the story of a person who is pushed to the outskirts of society, who is cut away from resources, who is cut away from the type of assistance they need to get medicine, to get therapy, to get help. And it really does show a tragic tale of how a person can completely fall off the map and become something truly evil. And I think that because the film does so many things to make that character sad but not tragic, or malevolent but not smart, that if you watch this movie and somehow came away with the idea that it was something to aspire to be like the Joker, well, that's a problem you need to figure out internally. That's definitely not the message of the movie. So it's sad that we're at this place in society, and those concerns and that controversy is very legitimate. The best that I can say is I did genuinely feel, as somebody who's very compassionate toward the issue, that the film doesn't go out of its way to nonchalantly idolize the Joker character, which I think is the best that you could have asked for. So, boy, that took kind of a dark turn. So should you see this movie? I think so. I think it's uncomfortable. I think it's weird. I think it's sad. I think it's beautiful. I think that it is a good example of when violence can be very effective and when ambiguity can really help with the script. So if you have the choice to go see it, I mean, I'd wait. I don't like seeing it with crowds, but I definitely would get around to doing it. That said, we have a lot more to discuss, so I hope to see you on our deeper dive and deeper discussion of Joaquin Phoenix and the Joker.